Hi, good afternoon. I don't want to be between you and tea break, so I'll try to make this engaging and entertaining, I hope. Yeah, I'm a Markku, yes, that's true. I'm a geek. I work at Google, that's it. So today, I'd like to show you Apache Beam, specifically with Python streaming. So if you know Apache Beam, data processing pipelines, originally it was Java, and then it was Python only for batch, and now finally we have Python streaming, yay. So that's what I will show you, basically how Apache Beam loves Python. So a little bit of history. What is Apache Beam and where does it come from? It's open source from Google. So Google is pretty big. We have YouTube and search and Gmails and this. So we have like 8 billion users. There's actually more users than people on the planet because many people use different services. So that's how the math works. Anyway, at Google scale, the engineers could not buy products
to build Google infrastructure, so they had to invent it.
What I really like about Google is that they open source and a lot of those things, and they also publish white papers on how and why they built these technologies. So on this chart, you can see some of those white papers from Google Research. The first two ones are GFS, Google File System, and then MapReduce. So they came out of Google Research, and they basically gave birth to Hadoop. And then Google was running MapReduce Hadoop for many years, but not anymore. We don't use it anymore because it's too slow for Google. It's copying data back and forth too much. It takes too much time to warm up and get going. So a lot of the research later at Google that are powering our internal services are focusing on real-time data processing. And specifically for today's talk, Apache Beam was born out of these two Google research things that then powered Google's internal data processing. So we call them internally Flume and Millwheel. No idea why. But they became Dataflow, first internally at Google, and now we open sourced it. So Dataflow was split into two. Apache Beam started running the software side. So the whole code was open sourced as Apache Beam. Apache Beam is this programming model of building data pipelines. And Beam is kind of a joke. It means batch and stream. So Beam, that's why it's Beam. So the really nice thing about Beam is that it's a unified model where you no longer have to have a Lambda. I don't mean AWS Lambda, I mean the Lambda architecture. So people tried to run something called Lambda architecture where you have the batch line and then the streaming pipeline. So that's basically two systems. The problem is that then you have two systems to maintain and manage and code. It's terrible. So Apache Beam is combining those into one system that can handle both batch data, so files, and streaming data in one system. And you can even merge them. You can handle pipelines with merging streaming and batch data. And that's what I will show you today, hopefully, in a live demo. So Apache Beam is the programming. Google Cloud Dataflow is one of the ways of running Beam. So if you want to run Beam in Google Cloud, then we have a service to run that automatically for you. So what is Beam? Beam is the unified programming model for batch and streaming pipelines. It's the same thing we run internally at Google for everything where we need data processing. So Beam can handle both batch and streaming. It supports both Java and Python. Python is a first-class citizen there, which is good. And then to run Beam, you can run it locally on your laptop, like my Mac here, with a so-called direct runner. So you run the Beam on your laptop. But of course, in production, you need to have distributed parallel processing scale out because you don't know how much data you have. So the laptop is not the best for that. It's good for development. If you want to use Google Cloud, you use Dataflow. If you want to manage yourself, you can use Apache, Flink, Spark, or APAC runtime environments. And what can you actually do with Beam? In the same pipelines, it can support different data inputs and data syncs. So reading from and writing to, and in the middle processing. And the one on the left is classic batch. So you have a file. You have a 5 GB file with maybe CSV rows, whatever. You run through that file. that's a patch. You can do windowed patch, where if you have a huge file or set of files for maybe a month, you can set a window of hourly patches, for example. So then you read through files, but you kind of chop them into hourly chunks. And at the end of the window, you emit the results, like aggregations, whatever. So that's patch. And then you have streaming data. Streaming data means that you actually have an endless stream of data packets coming in, and you process them on the fly. So that's even better than patch, in my opinion, because then you get the results immediately, within seconds at least. You don't have to wait for the patch run. Now, what is the last one? Streaming plus accumulation. That's a bit weird, but basically with streaming data, you have a problem with late packets. Late packets happen when there's a difference between generation of the data and actually processing the data. So let's say it's a mobile use case and you've got your phone, maybe you make a mobile app. The user does something, tweak, presses something, that's an event. So the timestamp of the event generated is now. But to process the data, first the packet has to go from the phone through the operator network, maybe to Google Cloud as an example. So there's a bit of transmission time, half a second, whatever. But then you might lose the packet. Whatever reasons, you know the phones can drop out. And then when the phone finally reconnects, it will retransmit the packet. So there might easily be a 5-minute delay between data generation and data processing. So the last one on the right there means that Apache Beam can actually handle late packets. If you have a time window, like you're calculating, whatever, player scores every minute. So at the end of the 1-minute window, you calculate the results and you shoot the results. In this time window, in this minute, these are the player scores. Then you get a late packet 10 minutes later, like, what do? Well, Apache Beam has built-in functionality for that. When you get the late packet, it will notice from the timestamp of the data generation, hey, this is a late packet, and you can simply have one line of code, update results. By the way, when I said earlier that these are the scores, here's an update. That's super difficult to do by yourself. So Beam has built-in functionality for late packets. Where is Beam? Of course, it's on GitHub, so it's just Apache/Beam, that's it. And if you see on the bottom, it says SDKs. So you go there, you click SDKs, and you find Python. And you find there, well, first of all, you can clone it on your laptop. You can pull it from with Python pip. And they have examples there. How to install it? So I built this presentation so that it can be an actual step-by-step guide for you to actually start using it. So that's why I start from the beginning. I'm sure all of you, because you are Python developers, you know pip and virtualenv. You don't have to use virtualenv, but just any virtual environment is a good idea, so you don't screw up your laptop's primary Python. But basically, this is how you can get started, literally with these steps. So you create, for example, a subdirectory and virtual environment, and then you pip install Apache Beam. And you may notice there the square brackets GCP. So if you want Apache Beam, your Beam, to talk to something like maybe Google Cloud or something, then you can have these specific modules installed together with the primary Apache Beam. So in this case, because I use Google Cloud, PubSub, and BigQuery later, I specified GCP, Google Cloud Platform. But there are many other options there too. And this code here, we won't even really look at it now. I will break it down for you later in the slides. That's an actual Hello Beam. So that's a streaming Beam pipeline with Python that works. That was the smallest one I managed to do for you guys here. So you can literally copy paste from the slide. We will share the slides later. Copy paste this code and it should run. This particular one is reading from Google Cloud PubSub message queue and writing any data you receive to text files. So very simple. But it is Beam, it is Python, and it is streaming Python, which is the new thing in Beam. So how would you run it? First, you probably run it locally on your laptop, just to do, do unit testing. So you simply in the active virtual environment, you simply execute Python hello beam, and you can specify some parameters. In this case, I use Google Cloud PubSub message queue. So I will say the topic, the message queue topic, is called beam test. And output file name structure would be beam.out. With all parallel processing, basically you will get something, something, something dot beam dot out, because you might have multiple workers and chunks. Anyway. And then runner. Runner specifies where you run the beam pipeline. Direct runner means here, locally. Data flow runner is Google Cloud data flow. You get the idea. So we run it. Then we can, for example, publish a message to a message queue. So that triggers, that emits a streaming packet. And then we can verify the output of beam simply by catting, outputting, if we have some beam.out files. So let's see a hello beam live example. So let's see what happens. First of all, here, I'm in my hello beam directory on my laptop, and I have that exact code as I had in the previous slide here. So I simply copy paste it from the slides. So that same code is here. It's not bad, it's like one page of code. I have an active virtual environment where I just now executed pip install Apache Beam brackets Google Cloud Platform. Why GCP? Because I use PubSub. And if I now, when I now execute this Python hello beam.py with direct runner, we start running this pipeline. So now it should be running on my laptop. I'm running Beam, I'm running that pipeline. And then we go here. This is the data source for our pipeline. This, in this case, it's Google Cloud PubSub. We have a topic beam test. And as you can see, there are no subscriptions to this message queue topic. Just now we started running Beam, so let me refresh this window and see if anything has changed. Yes, now there is a subscription. You may not see, it's a bit small font, but let me zoom in. Suddenly there is a subscription, beam underscore something something. So now that Apache Beam pipeline running on my laptop created a subscription. So it said that I'm interested in data streams running in this particular topic. So if we now publish a message, hello, of course we have to say hello, PyCon APAC 2018, tech coolness. All right, let's publish a message. Bang. So I sent a message to PubSub, and we drop down to the command line here. There is a new subdirectory, and there's something called beam.out. Yeah. So that worked. So now there's a file on my laptop created by Apache Beam, and it got the streaming data packet from Cloud PubSub in this case, and it output it here. So okay, that worked. So hello world works. We verified that. That's good. And the actual code is there in that previous slide in my presentation, so you can just literally copy paste it and follow the same steps. And I documented all the steps there. I wanted to make this a hello world for you so you can try Beam. Let's talk a little bit more about what is Beam. So Apache Beam is intended to be the replacement of legacy data processing systems like Hadoop. And the main concept is that Beam, when you program Beam, you are defining a DAG, directed acyclic graph. With cloud computing and distributed computing, we always generate terms that give people headache, right? Eventually consistent and idempotent and all these things. Yes. So again, we are generating headache. Thank you. For ourselves, we are giving ourselves the pain. So what is a DAG? Basically, a Beam pipeline is a set of transformations where you specify what you want to do with your data, and then you're sending the result of that transformation to another transformation. Hop, there you go. So I'm doing something, I get some data, and my output, hop, goes to the next guy, until there's the last guy. the last transformation in the previous pipeline was write to file. Why is it acyclic? We don't want to have an eternal loop, you know, go to 10. We don't want the pipeline to run forever. It has to go one way, it cannot go back. Directed forward, acyclic, no looping back. That's it. Oh yes, and it has to be parallelizable and serializable. More headaches here. So serializable means that the data you pass between the nodes has to be serializable. You have to be able to, like Dennis was talking earlier, you have to be able to put the data on the wire and send it to someone else. Great. And it, because it has to be scalable as a data processing system, it has to scale out. It has to be parallelizable. So all the transformations you define with Apache Beam can be running on multiple nodes at the same time. So that's how it scales. Bounded and unbounded are more weird terms. Bounded just means batch data, files. Unbounded is streaming data, real-time data. It doesn't have boundaries, it's endless. So Beam supports both. Typically with unbounded, you have a window. Because if you have a file, it's very easy. You start at the beginning of the file and you read the whole file. Done, that's batch. With real-time streaming, you just tap into the stream, it's like a river, and you try to count the fish in the river going past or zip. When do you stop? Like, how many fish are there? When? So then you can like take a stopwatch and start counting the fish now. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, stop. Okay, 3 fish. So that's a time window. Because you want to have results, sometimes, with streaming data, you apply a window, like 1 minute window. Count how many fish there are in 1 minute. And then you start counting again the next minute. And at the end of the window, you shoot the results. There were 3 fish. Next minute, there were 5 fish. So how do you do Beam in Python? That's the link to the currently latest SDK. Imports, supposed to say imports. So how do you import the data? Very normally, you just import in your Beam Python pipeline code. First of all, a lot of the standard Python libraries and modules are already there, but if you need to import extra libraries, how do you know? When you run pipeline, it says unknown module, okay? So then you want to import it. When you run Beam pipelines, you can specify then a requirements file. So when you specify the requirements file and you start the Beam pipeline, you just say requirements file equals this file, then Apache Beam will first download and install these extra modules. So it's a very normal Python way of supporting additional modules. Standard import in your code, requirements.txt file. Okay, let's look at the general structure of Apache Beam in Python. In the beginning there, you define a run function. And on the bottom we have main, for example. So we just simply run this run function. And there you can see I highlighted a part, p.run. P is the pipeline. You can see it formed above there, but that's in the next slide. So basically you run the pipeline, and then because it's a streaming pipeline, the second line is important. Wait until finish. So then you start running the pipeline function, but you run it forever until you either break it if you're running it locally, or you call stop function. You call stop. Next. You pass some command line arguments. Typically, it's a good idea to do. So for example, you might be parsing what is my message queue topic that I'm reading from, what is my database as an input, or maybe another database as an output. So you can parse command line arguments. And Beam itself has its own options as well. So Beam has some standard options that you can use. And then because it's a streaming pipeline, we have here streaming equals true. So that's the other important thing for streaming Python. So basically wait until finish, run forever, and then streaming equals true. Those two things mean that it's a streaming Python Beam pipeline. And then what actually happens is that you have P collections and P transforms. P collections are your data, the data you pass between the transformations. And P transforms are the transforms, how you manipulate your data. So P collection is P collection is Beam terminology for your data. It's an iterable collection. Because Apache Beam is parallel processing, distributed system, it can have multiple nodes running the same transforms. The data elements are distributed across these nodes. So the data that you're actually processing in Beam has to be iterable, because that's how Beam will basically go through, for example, a list or array of these data records and distributes those to the workers. So you have to have an iterable collection of data. So in Python, the easiest one is a list. You just package your data in a list. And those list elements will then be given to multiple workers. Very easy. The other thing to note is that data is immutable. It doesn't change. Beam does not change the source data. It gets a copy of the source data. You manipulate it with your code and you output another P collection. You have an input P collection, immutable, output P collection. Who is transforming the data are P transforms. They are in practice functions that are working on your data. You write the functions. So in practice, the graph looks like this. Input P collection, maybe in this case the PubSub topics coming in. First transformation, interim data. Second transformation, final output. So that's how you work. How do you get data? So here I highlighted records. Records is the first P collection where we read data from the original data source. So we start from the beginning. We will connect to the original data source. It could be a set of files somewhere, object store or physical files, whatever. Or it could be a streaming data topic that we tap into. That's where the data will go. Where does it come from? We have to first create the pipeline. So in Apache Beam, this P is the pipeline. So we define the pipeline, we define the graph. And then we apply transformations. This is a bit weird. We apply them with a pipe, a Unix pipe, basically. So you have some data, some pipeline, and then you apply a transformation. You pipe transformations through the data. You can give them a title. So for example, in logging or in some UIs, you can then see the title of the transformation. So the first transformation is called read from PubSub. So you can see when you investigate the graph, for example, in Google Dataflow, you can see there a node and it says read from PubSub. And then this is the actual transformation. We are using the Beam built-in I/O functionality, so beam.io, input and output. And in this case, we are using read strings from PubSub. So that's one of those GCP functionalities, if you want to use Google Cloud. We have built-in functionality, for example, for reading and writing to PubSub, our global message queue. So here we read from PubSub. Which topic? And then we can deduplicate records in this case with the message ID. So PubSub guarantees at least once data delivery. So you might get a duplicate packet sometimes. So this one is automatic deduplication. It doesn't process the same packet ID twice. So here we can then pipe transformation. So a graph is not very useful if there's only one node there. You don't really need Beam for that. When you have multiple transformations, you can chain them together. You can pipe them. So the dictionaries here is the final output. Dictionaries are the final output of what? First transformation, read data from PubSub, and then the output of PubSub, the output of read from PubSub is then piped to the second transformation. So So first transformation, get the original data. Second transformation is getting the output of the first one. In this case, the second one is simply using a simple lambda function, so one-line function, to take the original data record and change it from JSON to Python dictionary. So original data source is JSON, we just change it to a dictionary, and then the output of this lambda function goes here to dictionaries. So two transformations that will output a list of dictionaries that you can then work on. What are we actually doing here? The second transformation is using a Beam built-in map functionality. So you can see some of the history back to MapReduce. So with map, you do parallel processing of data. You distribute the data across multiple workers and you execute a function on the data. In this case, we don't even call any function that we define somewhere else. It's a one-line embedded function. We use a lambda, Python lambda function, to simply apply a JSON loads to the data record. So E is the data record. It's one of those messages from PubSub. So that's something that Beam calls pardo, parallel do. So it looks like this. You have your original data, let's say messages from PubSub. It's a list of dictionaries, for example. So it has to be iterable. Then when you call a pardo, parallel do, so you get the idea, parallel do, parallel execution of transformations. The data records, the original data records are distributed across multiple workers potentially. Each one of the workers is running your functions to transform the data, aggregation, data cleanup, whatever, counting averages, and it's outputting an iterable list, is a good idea, set of outputs. And those are collected again and passed to the next transformation. Input P collection, P transform in the middle, output P collection. So how do you actually do that? In Python, you define a class, and you can see there beam.dofn. So that's the template, if you will. So I call this add key to dictionary. So you define a class in your code, and the pardo function has to have, or class has to have, a process function. So this is what it's called. You call the process, Beam is calling the process function, and the element is your input data. Element contains the data you are supposed to work on. And then in this case, I simply return a key value pair of the client ID in that data dictionary and the dictionary itself. So I change a dictionary into a key value pair where the key is one of the values and the value is the original dictionary. Anyway, you get the idea, it's not that bad. So input data, small change to the data, small transformation, and then you output. And note here, very crucially, you note the brackets here, the square brackets. So originally I didn't do this when I started playing and I failed miserably. You have to provide an iterable output. You might be wondering what happens if you don't put the brackets here. And I learned the hard way. That's the best way to learn. If you just return a dictionary, Beam thinks that that's an iterable output for the next step. So you return a nice dictionary with maybe 10 different key value pairs. That dictionary was spread out to multiple workers as the next step. So if you have a dictionary like a hash map table and you have attribute 1, value 1, attribute 2, value 2, those were spread out. Nice. No more dictionary. It was super weird after that. I was trying to debug it, and can you imagine like distributed parallel processing where your dictionary that you think is one dictionary was spread out like that? And I started seeing log messages from distributed systems, like, what is going on here? That's why I'm stressing this. Encase it in a list and everything is good. So basically you're just returning a list with one element in it, but that's good enough. Then your dictionary remains as one dictionary. Nobody breaks it for you. So this is, on the top is how you define the pardo, your transformation. Here, highlighted in green is where you actually call the P transform. So this is the Beam pipeline. So we just say records is your source data here. You pipe it to your pardo, and you just call here add key to dictionary, the name of the class. Now where's the data? The data is implied. The data is the element. So this line here, which actually executes your class or calls your class, calls your process function automatically and automatically passes the input data, records, to the elements. So it's implied there. A graph is much better if you do things like branching and joining. So here's an example of branching. You can't really see probably, but you can read data from a common source like PubSub. And then the output here that I'm highlighting, the first output here can be read by two different branches of the pipeline. So on the left side, we are doing windowing and group by key and all kind of averaging. And on the right side, we just write the raw data to a database like Google BigQuery. So you can branch data. I talked about windowing earlier. So in an eternal stream of packets, you just decide on time windows. And then you calculate things like averages inside the time window. We will share all the slides so you can see all the details. And hopefully you can copy paste and get running with these slides. How do you do windowing? You just apply built-in Beam functionality, window into. So create a window, sliding windows, 300 seconds or 5 minute long sliding windows that are triggering every minute. So every minute you close a window and you look at the data from the last 5 minutes. Output, average value of the last 5 minutes. 1 minute. 1 minute later, same thing, last 5 minutes. Then you can do things like group by key, etc. Writing output to a final data store is very simple. We use the Beam IO functionalities, and then you just choose which data store you're writing to. This example is with Google BigQuery, but it's just a database, it's a data warehouse. So Beam IO, write somewhere, and then write what. So the final transformation in your graph is taking the final P collection of data, and you write it to the final data store. Now it doesn't have to be a static data store like files or databases. You can also write to a message queue. So that's interesting. And with Beam, you can write to multiple data destinations. So you can branch one set of data coming in into multiple use cases. So for example, you can start writing directly to archive storage, a backup data. And then you can start writing to a real-time graph that's showing some kind of metrics as a real-time updating graph. Then you can start averaging and writing, for example, every hour, every minute, every month, every day, aggregations to some data warehouse for analysts. So from the same data, you can have multiple use cases branching out. That's quite cool. How do you do logging? Normal Python logging. In the main function here, you'll just say logging, get logger, set level to info, for example. And then in your actual code, so in practice in your P transformations, those functions you define, you just say logging.info and whatever, you just output something. Running tests locally on your laptop is probably a good idea with Direct Runner, so you can see what's going on here. And then when you're running production, you probably want to run in some big cluster somewhere, Apache Flink or maybe Google Cloud, whatever. Then you specify another runner, and that's it. But the same pipeline works on your laptop and in the big systems. So now, I have 6 minutes left, I want to show you an end-to-end demo using this. So I wanted to build a little shop that handles data engineering in real time. So kind of legacy thing, barcode scanner in a SAP, but then processing those sales in real time, end to end. So I wanted to build something like this. I have products like these potato chips here. They have a barcode, I have a barcode reader. And then if I scan those barcodes, the barcode contains very little information. It's the fact record of, this is the barcode of the product we sold. But what is the name of the product? What is the price of the product? What is the shipping cost? What is the tax? What is the size of the box in storage? All those extra information are like dimensions. So people talk about fact data, limited main data like barcode, which is the ID or the key, and dimension data like name of the product. So I need to do this. I need to start scanning products and streaming in real time those sales, and we are just streaming the barcodes that we are selling and when with timestamp. So probably need to send them to some message queue. And then I have the dimension table. I need to have some kind of database that knows that this barcode is actually these potato chips. And this one is dried Korean fish soup. And these are chocolate biscuits. So that information has to be in a product catalog, so typically a database, right? So what I need to do in the red insert magic here part is take the streaming data with the fact records, use the key, the barcode as the lookup key, get the dimension data from the database, enrich the data, join the data, and write it to a data warehouse. So to do that, I did this. So I use Google Cloud PubSub as the message queue for data ingestion and real-time streaming. Google Cloud Data Store, our simple document database for the product catalog. Dataflow or direct runner to run Beam, and then BigQuery, our data warehouse, as the destination for the data. So BigQuery data warehouse should then get rows for sales where one row has all the data. It's enriched, it's joined data. And we are joining streaming data with static data. So, not yet, let's see the live demo first. So, let's start the pipeline running. I'm using direct runner. So the bottom, let me make it bigger so that you can actually see something. The bottom terminal there is now starting to run this Beam pipeline. That is supposed to enrich and join the data. Okay, and then we are running Beam. Where is our product catalog? It's here. This one is one of our database services called Data Store. And you can see here that I have defined in the catalog three products. There's dried Polak soup, biscuit sticks, and potato chips. Mm. And the key for each one of them is actually the barcode. So on the barcode, there are some numbers on the bottom. So the magic of the barcode is that the barcode is the string of numbers. So that's the key. And then the destination in this case is a table in BigQuery. The table is dataset called retail, and there's a table called POS, point of sale. And to actually start using the system, let's start on my laptop, a simple Python app running on my lap that is connected to Cloud Data Store Catalog and Cloud PubSub for emitting real-time records. So I'm running on my laptop now this simple app that I wrote to, and I intentionally make it look like 1980s point of sale system. So if we, for example, look at the current catalog, we are pulling from the data store database that we have three products. Delicious Bokuk, Polak soup, and chocolate biscuit sticks, for example. That's fine. And if we go to the point of sale mode of the app, welcome to Google Cloud SAP. Let's start buying products. So let's start with the fish soup. So there's the barcode. There you go. Bang. Oi, almost ruined everything. Now you can see here a lot of data in the Apache Beam pipeline. So I'm debug outputting on the Beam pipeline. You could see that the POS system actually scanned the product and immediately pretty much we saw here some data. Product key is the actual barcode. And for example, this delicious Bukok, cannot, how do you pronounce it? Kamsahamnida. That one was pulled from the data store. So this is an already enriched record. Let's buy a bit more products. let's buy some pokey sticks, maybe 3 pokies. And then let's also buy some Pringles. Here we go. So you may have noticed that some stuff happened here and more data records were handled by Beam. If we now go to Cloud BigQuery, which is the destination data sync, and I query and I sort by order date, the latest data records, here we go. We have some Pocky, we have some Pringles, sour cream and onion as the last products bought. So in our data warehouse here, we now have data streaming in from the point of sale system, and the data pipeline is enriching the data, streaming data with catalog data, joining the data, writing to data warehouse in data streaming mode. So the point here is that then data analysts, business intelligence, can actually start working on the data warehouse, and the data is up to date immediately. You don't have to batch any data to your data warehouse. It's real-time streaming end to end. So that's cool. That means that then your business decision making, whatever, can basically be real time with Apache Beam. You don't get the results tomorrow. The data warehouse is up to date in real time. Hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much. Yes, sir.
Yeah,
I was just reading some. I knew you would ask that question. I preempted that, cloud jokes. It just said that currently some of the transforms, whatever, don't support Python 3, but there are a lot of requests for that. I don't know when. Because it's an open source community project, the guys and ladies are working on it now. Currently it's 2.7. In the back. Yeah, so Apache Beam itself handles all of that. So indeed, Beam will persist the data for the window as long as needed. It uses disks as well, and it's doing smart flushing and caching to the disk. So for example, the runners, the nodes that are running the Apache Beam, you may in some cases need to increase storage size for those nodes if you want to persist a lot of data. You can also preload some data, it's called side inputs. So for example, you might have a dimension table and you might want to persist that on the disks if it doesn't change very often. And if that table is very big, you may need to increase the disk size, so virtual disk size. But Beam handles all that behind the scenes. It's just that if you run out of space, then you need to increase the space.
So how it is different from AWS Kinesis? So it has PubSub as well as something new, like Kinesis Analytics, where you can do SQL queries in real-time streaming.
Well, the biggest difference probably is that this is an open source community project. So it's a very popular project in Apache. It's very multi-platform, it's very open. Google Cloud Dataflow is one way to run it, but Apache Beam is fully open source and people are running it on Spark, etc. And it's contributed by the community. Even though it was originally open sourced by Google, just like Kubernetes and TensorFlow, it's an open source community. Yeah, that's the biggest difference. Yes?
How does Beam handle large data input in terms of performance?
Well, by large data, do you mean files or streaming data? Stream, yeah. Actually, the same answer for both. So if you have a lot of data coming in, Beam can realize that, and then it can start adding more nodes and basically scaling out. So it can detect that, oh, I have a streaming pipeline. It looks at the timestamps and it realizes, I'm falling behind. So my processing is so slow, the timestamps are getting further and falling behind. Then it can add more nodes. But of course, your runner where you run Beam has to have more nodes available that it can scale out then. Yeah. Yes?
You talked about PubSub being a ingestion engine, right?
Well, one example here, yeah.
Is it possible to have something like Kafka? Yeah.
Absolutely, yeah. It's just that because I'm from Google Cloud, it was easy for me to use PubSub, but Kafka is a very popular example as a another message queue for either input or output. Yes.
Is it possible to use it as a tree analysis, kind of like, for example, in the JSON to dict, what if there is some inside JSON string, which is in JSON, and inside the those JSON string, another JSON string is in it. So if, what if we need to like,
Yeah, absolutely. Beam is exactly built for that. So if you have a complex data model, you need to open up and branch the data. You just define more transforms. So first you would like open up the main JSON, and the output of that could be like then pass to the next transformations. You can branch them, you can later join them back, maybe with some common key.
But what if we don't know the how big is the depth?
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You can, because Beam will pass. The data are called P collections, and they are iterable. So you can have an endless list of data. So Beam will just take this P collection. It can have as many millions of elements. Doesn't matter. It will start sending those to parallel workers in the next transformation. Of course, the performance will be better than if you have a lot of workers. But even with one worker, it will iterate through that list. It's just a bit slower with one worker. With more workers, it's scaling horizontally. But short answer is yes, that's exactly what Beam was built to do. You just have to define the graph. Like what, this is my input data, this is the structure. I don't know how long it is, the list, but it doesn't matter. This is the structure. How do I open it up? How do I process it? And how do I collect the results? That's when you design the pipeline. And Beam has built-in functionalities like aggregations and these to make it easier for you to implement this pipeline.
Debugging is always super difficult.
Hurts. Yeah, hurts. This is the pain here. Ah, yes.
And like, let's say you have 20 different transforms happening.
Yeah.
And there's a problem on the 17th.
Yeah.
But you no longer have the context of the 16th or the 1st or anything you can put there. Is there tracing or how does debugging work?
Yeah, so you can output logging, and then each one of those workers and transforms will be able to log output. And you can, of course, have a timestamp there as well. So you can see that at this time, this transformation or one of the nodes of this transformation output something. Of course, then it's better if you have a logging dashboard or system where you can get a better overview of all these distributed logs. So this is not meant to be any product plug or anything, but like if you run Dataflow in Google, we have Stackdriver, which then gives you this capability. But if you just want to collect the log records and use another system to analyze the logs, then it's better if it can help you at least do like time series analysis of like putting the timestamps, from the timestamps constructing what happened.
But if you have like hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of messages a second, that's not practical.
Yeah, yeah. So the honest answer is that Beam itself doesn't really care. Beam just gives you the logging output. But then what you do with the logs, yes, that's something you need to consider.
A request ID chain that you can follow.
Ah, yeah. Not to my knowledge, but there are some other open source projects like Zipkin, if I remember right, which are like distributed systems logging and analysis. So I'm just guessing here, maybe you could insert Zipkin modules, and then Zipkin could be the system that understands the distributed processing. This is just a guess, and I have never tried that, but yeah.
But Zipkin is all about the tracing, but not like distributed logging. Like, I would say you would need a syslog or a logrus for the log stash.
Yeah, because there's two different things you want to do, tracing and understanding distributed logs, yeah.
There is another technology developed, I'm not sure by which, it's called Visceral. Visceral, it's a visualization graph, so you can build a networking tracking or any data system tracking events. So basically, you can define a graph in JSON file and say, like, Visceral, just visualize that. And it will show you, like, circles on the UI, and then it will show, like, a small dots crossing from one node to another, depending on the relationship between nodes.
Yeah.
You basically can track where the traffic's where is the successful traffic, where the failed events happen. So basically, you can measure the percentage of the problems, and it helps people to understand the visualization problem of the events where the problem happens in the first place. Just as you asked, if the problem happens on the 17th, we don't have a context of the 16th.
Yeah, that's great. Jakku you, Dennis. So basically, yes. So Beam is open source. It's producing standard logging output, but because it's a distributed system, it's a good idea to look at other systems to help you understand distributed logging. Yes, at scale. Very true. Yes.
You mentioned that it can handle late update. So does it store the middle results somewhere?
Late updates work with the Windows. And yes, it also remembers the previous results. So when you activate the support for late packets, it has to know that, in this time window, this was the original result, and then now there's an update for that one. So Beam has built-in functionality for that.
But there is a ton of nodes there.
So yeah, Beam handles that. It doesn't matter which particular node ran it, they are not stateful, they are still stateless.
They're so central to the server.
How exactly Beam handles the late packet handling under the hood, I'm not quite sure. So, yeah. But it's open source, it's on GitHub.
Provisional results and final results. And the result that you get at the end of the window is provisional.
Yeah.
But then you say, any packet that comes in the next hour, I'm still going to accept that.
Yes, true.
After an hour, your provisional result becomes a final result. And if a packet comes in after an hour, it's dropped.
Yeah. Very good, thank you.
Another question.
Yes, please.
When you're windowing data, on a particular key, right?
Yes.
All the data pertaining to that particular key is probably going to go to the same worker, right?
If you do a group by key, so the interesting thing is that when you activate a window, say a 5-minute window, the window doesn't actually start working until an aggregation needs it. So it's a bit funny. So first you say in the beginning of the pipeline, start a window every 5 minutes. Then you have transforms. Windowing doesn't work until you call an aggregation. And then the aggregation, like group by key, that will then use the window. So the window will materialize, collect the data, and then split them by key for the group by key. That's the interesting concept. So it's a bit weird from programming point of view. You say in the beginning, start a window. Then you have a transformation that doesn't use windowing, so it doesn't use windowing.
But does that mean that every data event that comes in for a particular key all goes into the same worker?
No. It's more of the concept of the windowing, and then the group by key will handle it then. Yeah. Okay. We are slightly over time. Any more questions? Maybe one more, if you have any questions. I think you all want tea, so let's break for tea now. Thank you so much.